We are here to celebrate the life of Dr. Nancy Kensicki. My name is Reverend Leo Yates, Dr. Reverend Leo Yates. I am a twin, that's why my sign name is Leo, like twin. I'm going to take the opportunity to open up with a brief prayer. You have many different names. Lord, what's important is your love that you spread and what we're experiencing here today. We pray for comfort, we pray for unity, and we also pray for our grief and loss this afternoon. Thank you for the life, Nancy. Clearly you loved and cherished people, and for the people watching here joining us via Zoom, thank you so much. Amen. I do want to share a brief poem. It's called Remember Me. To the living, I am gone. To the sorrowful, I will never return. I cannot be seen or heard, but I can be felt. So as you stand upon the shore, gazing at a beautiful sea, remember me. As you look in awe at a mighty forest and its grand majesty, remember me. As you look upon a flower and admire its simplicity, remember me. Remember me in your heart, your thoughts, your memories of the times we loved. Remember when we cried. Remember the times we fought and the times we laughed. For you will always think of me. I will never really be gone. Amen. I'd like to invite Dr. Linda Kensicki.
My mom told me at a very early age that I could be anything as long as I work for it. She told me that my life was what I made it. I had to work hard for what I wanted. No one would give me anything if I did not earn it. She did not say this with a sense of adulation or fiction or prose. She meant it because it was up to me, but only me, just like it was always up to her and only her. I think that she saw herself in me, but to be honest, I never measured up to her.
Up, it was a gag.
All the while, the song player, if you're into evil, you're a friend of mine. She felt the vibrations, but thought it was a kitchen club. I told her afterwards of the song and how loud it was. She was immediately cross that I took advantage of her deafness, and she was absolutely 100% right. Of course, this was completely inappropriate and wrong for me to do on many levels. She was angry at me for about 30 seconds, and then she just started hysterically laughing. She thought it was absolutely hilarious. The Shocked Nuns, AC/DC playing, and she, a middle-aged mother, waiting in the car for her daughter coming out of the cabin. The ridiculousness of this scene was just hilarious to her. She always pushed boundaries, and that was just one example. She laughed and laughed and asked me to write out the lyrics, and then she laughed some more. She always asked me to retell that story with the whole thing together. Every time we saw each other. She found the whole episode to be shockingly funny. My mother was funny. She had an acerbic wit. She was fiercely proud. She loved Chardonnay, watching movies, going out to dinner, reading science fiction, and hearing any story that I told her. I miss her so much. I love her. The world feels so different without her in it, but I am so grateful to know her and to have her alive.
There's three important points that you might not know.
So my sister told me a lot, and she shared three particular stories with me that come to mind. Nancy decided to leave Gallaudet after her freshman year. She passed all her courses, but she decided to leave. She didn't necessarily quit school, but she took a leave of absence. She thought she would go out and have a different life, enjoy herself. She had a boyfriend at the time, a couple of them, and I never liked any of them. She had a lot of friends. Someone she met her husband to be, and they met at a basketball tournament that she went to and just fell in love. And just thought he was so handsome, handsome Peter. She just loved him, and they got married. Only after 7 months of dating, and I was with my wife for 3.5 years before we married, so it's okay. The wedding was beautiful, and there's some pictures being shown here on the loop. So, they lived in Columbus, Ohio. And they lived in an apartment. It was about 20 feet away from the train tracks, and they would feel those trains coming through. It was quite loud. So I did see her often, and one day, she had heard about Gallaudet special program, and I can't remember. remember exactly what it was, and there was, so we came out to Gallaudet, and Elizabeth Benton was the dean of the women's school, who was a wonderful woman. She was very, very strict. Nobody could do anything in front of her. She would tell the boys to get out of the dorm, and the girls to get out of the boys' dorm, so she was quite strict. But she presented, and she actually saw Nancy in the audience, and she knew Nancy. And after her presentation, she approached Nancy and said, "Nancy, are you married?" She proudly put up her hand and showed her wedding band. And the presenter said, "Do you have a job?" And she said, "Well, I'm doing some odd jobs here and there." And the presenter said, "You know what? I know you're quite bright. I want you to come to Gallaudet. Come back to Gallaudet." And Nancy said, "No, no." And the reason why, even the presenter said that she was so intelligent. And you said to her, "You have to come back to Gallaudet because you are so smart." So she went about explaining to her that she would have a better job, a better life, and she would be able to provide a better life for her family. So she went back to her cancer, went back to her husband, and said, "What do I do?" And they had a very serious discussion about what she should do. And what she ended up doing is asking her mother for support. Back then, in 1962, there was no TTY, there was no video phones or Zoom, so she had to drive over to her mom's house, sit down, and explain to her what she wanted to do. And her mom said, "That's great." And she said, "Would you support me to go to college? And the expenses too?" And her mom responded, "Nope, this is something that you have to do on your own." So Nancy was thinking, "Oh, this is going to be difficult," and she seriously wanted to consider it. But somehow her husband, just one day, said to Nancy, "You know what? We better get busy and pack because we're going to Gallaudet. We're going to Washington, D.C." She said, "No, no. I have my parents here, I have friends here," and her husband said, "Nope, we're going. Period. End of discussion." So she packed up her bags, she packed everything she had, packed it into the car, brought it, went to Gallaudet, and it happened in just one day. She got here in Washington, D.C., and she lived in the back of campus, which is a pretty bad area, and I thought, "Oh, I hope she's okay back there." But she went to school for 3 years, so she came back as a sophomore. She was a junior, senior year, and she made the dean's list every single year. She was quite impressive. She graduated, and she was thrilled. So she then decided to go to grad school to become a teacher. While her husband was in New York City for some print work training, Nancy ended up moving to Ballard House right on Homestead Green. And she became a residential advisor. And she worked at Delta Epsilon Sorority as a supervisor or an advisor to another group of women. Oh, I felt so bad. She had some students that broke up with their boyfriends, and she had to counsel them, and other women in the house always needed help, and she was there to give everyone the support they needed. So I felt for her. She graduated with a grad degree, and that was fantastic. But she said, "You know what? I want to become a teacher here at Gallaudet." And she was determined. She talked to Dr. William Stokey, previous chairperson of the English department. And unfortunately, all the positions were full, all the staff positions were full, and there was no available teaching slot. But she was offered by the Illinois School for the Deaf a position, this was in Jacksonville, Illinois, a position to teach. And she didn't want to go there, she wanted to teach here. She was quite happy about it. Somehow, Dr. Stanley invited all of the teachers, as well as some grad students, for a party. I do believe that the party was at the old gym right on campus. And Nancy, you know, sadly went to this party. And she was quite upset that she couldn't get a position, but somehow a gentleman stood up and was trying to get everyone's attention. And everyone turned to this gentleman. And this gentleman is Robert. And Robert, a famous American deaf author and a poet, was just amazing. And Robert Panera says at that party, I am resigning from Gallaudet to become the chair of the Rochester Institute of Technology in New York. And that was a promotion for him, and that included, of course, the National Technical Institute, NTID. So made that announcement at the party because he was very proud he got this position. He grew up in New York and wanted to go back to his hometown. So that was the announcement that was made, and Nancy immediately thought, well, she kept her cool. She didn't say, oh, I'm so excited this person's leaving. She stayed composed. But she had an idea. That happened on a Saturday afternoon, and she was really excited. When Monday morning rolled around, she went into Dr. Stern's office and thought, well, she was worried about him being upset and losing Dr. Pettigrew. And he saw Nancy come in, and Nancy said, hi, Dr. Stokey. And he kind of chuckled and said, I've got enough time for you. But then he said, you know what? Wait a minute, come on in. You are hired. And that's what he told her by just Nancy walking into his office. So she worked for 38 years. And she absolutely loved the life that she had and the choice that she made to teach. I am very, very, very proud of her and her accomplishments. She was the first deaf female to receive her PhD in English. I couldn't be more proud of her. Just like my mother, she was also an English teacher, so she took after our mother, which I found very interesting. I do miss her quite a bit. I can't believe she's gone due to heart problems. I don't know the details. However, I also lost my wife, Barbara, so I'm grieving. And she was passed in 1970. She lost the battle to cancer. So it is very, very difficult for me to lose my sister and my wife.
Thank you for those remarks. Beautiful words. Now I would like to invite to the stage Coleen Kensicki, daughter-in-law.
She loved to listen and to Ralph Waldo Emerson asked the question, what is success? And he writes, to laugh often and much, to win the respect of intelligent people and the affection of children, to earn the appreciation of honest critics and endure the betrayal of false friends, to appreciate beauty, to find the best in others, to leave the world a bit better, whether by a healthy child, a garden patch, or a redeemed social condition. To know even one life has breathed easier because you have lived. This is to have succeeded. Bravo, Emcee. What a success story your life.
Although living in another country has meant that I do not see my grandmother very often. my mother, who loved her so, so much as I do. Stories of her humor and practicality will always remind me of what a wonderful woman she was. I think of her every time I play solitaire, as she always did on her office computer, and every time I read through her extremely detailed photo albums and scrapbooks. I am reminded of my grandmother and the profound impact she has had on me and my family every single day. Grammy was a brilliant, adventurous woman with unrivaled determination. She has and always will be an incredible, intelligent and memorable teacher, mother, grandmother, sister, friend, and partner to Papa. She is loved by so many. Though I know we all miss Grammy so much, she is still alive in every heart and mind that she touched during her precious life.
Hello everyone, my name is Albert Marsh. I'm going to share some remarks on my behalf and then on behalf of my mother who cannot be here today, Elizabeth. So Nancy was one of the earliest teachers that I've ever had. Know that I was never one of her students officially, but she was most definitely one of my teachers, earlier teachers in life, and I'm going to tell you a little bit about that. And as you know, part of that culture is we tell fairly long stories, so I will be sharing a couple stories with you today. Back in the 1970s, one of my earliest memories, as I was reading Nancy's obituary, I was remembering parts of my childhood and early stories, and I remember in the 70s, back in Kettering, Maryland, where her family had moved to. They moved to Sutton Drive in 1970. They were just a block around the corner from myself and my family. We were in Trafton Drive, so pretty much walking distance from us and my family. My mom and Nancy went to college together. They were college friends. They were both part of the Delta Epsilon sorority. And they had a lifelong friendship. Nancy enrolled in Catholic University, where she earned her PhD. At that time, my mom was one of the librarians at Catholic University. This was from the late 60s all the way to some point in the 70s. And they remained friends throughout life. Know that back then we did not have video phones, and we would use the TTY. We had that big old school TTY machine that some of you may remember. Very clunky, took a lot of space. And one of my earliest memories is having that TTY at home. I remember Nancy calling my mom. And I would ask, Mom, who is this? And she would say, it's Nancy calling. I was like, all right. And then Nancy would call several times throughout the week. I was a very young boy. I was still learning how to read and write. There were books around the house with English television with captions at that time. So I would often pay attention to the conversation that they were having in the TTY. I would look at the TTY roll and see what they were talking about. The black font was RN, where the red font was Nancy's N of the conversation. I remember that one day I was standing near the TTY, Nancy called, and I looked over, watching their conversation. conversation, and then my mom said, "Hey, Albert's here," and Nancy responded, "Hey, Albert," and I was just overjoyed that she had said my name. My name was printed on the TTY machine, and I could see my name in print. And again, she would call often. We did not have, every time I would see the flashing lights of the TTY, I would go to my mom and make sure that she knew that Nancy was calling, and they would often have conversations through the TTY. I started practicing myself on how to type on the TTY, and I remember that one day, I was just looking at what mom did on the TTY, and just one day I saw that Nancy was calling, so I decided to answer the TTY. I pressed the TTY, I put the phone on the machine. I said, "Hi, this is Albert, go ahead." And then she called once again, and I would do that again and start practicing typing my name. "Albert here, go ahead." And Nancy was listening, and says, "Nancy, go ahead." And I wrote A. And then I went to my mom, "Mom, where's the letter L in the TTY?" And she would show me, and then I go back to her, "Where's the R? I couldn't find the R," so I went to find my mom. "Hey mom, where's the R in the TTY machine? Where's the T?" And then I clicked, "Go ahead." And then my mom realized that someone was actually on the phone. I was just not asking her for letters randomly. She thought I was playing with the TTY. I was actually having a real conversation with Nancy. And then she took over the conversation and she started talking to Nancy herself. But that's how I started practicing reading and writing and having these conversations, these brief interactions with Nancy through the TTY. So I knew a lot of Nancy through our conversations via TTY. I remember in middle school we had to take a TTY typing class. I was lucky enough that I already had a phenomenal teacher who was Nancy, who had taught me early on how to work with TTY. My mom had taught me how to type my name, so I came in with some skills ready to my TTY class. Nancy never hung up on me. She was an incredibly patient person. That's why I said I was one of her earlier students, or one of her, she was one of my earliest teachers. They moved to Bumbui, and my family moved to Frederick. And regardless, my mom and Nancy kept in touch through the years. And now I would like to share some remarks on behalf of my mom. My mom wanted to say to Nancy, "Thank you for being such a wonderful friend, sorority sister, and being involved in so many organizations and activities in our community. Often going to the Deaf Picnic in Kettering. I remember that vividly, going and having a great time. She was a wonderful ally while raising her families, their family, and my family, back in the early 70s. We also worked together on a few occasions. Nancy or my mom taking turns hosting the annual Deaf March birthday brunch for deaf folks in the DC, Maryland, and Virginia area. And in sum, Nancy had a profound impact on many people's lives, including my parents, my brother, and myself. And when I think of the early TTY days, I will always remember Nancy."
Thank you.
grieve the loss of a wonderful person, a great leader, alumni, mother, friend, community activist, and advocate. I wanted to note that our interim provost, Jeff Lewis, typically would be here for an event such as this when a faculty member has passed away, but unfortunately he's out of town and unable to be here, and so I'm happy to be here in his stead. And as the first female president to be here in honor of a very significant woman in our deaf community is an honor for me, in fact. Throughout this program, you'll be hearing from a number of different people who originate from Gallaudet, are members of the deaf community, friends and leaders within the deaf community. And I wanted just to share a few things. You've heard some wonderful stories from family members as to who she was as a mother, what she meant to you as a member of your family, as a mother, and what you saw she was able to do. You know, many of us now will begin to talk about the impact that she had on all of us as not being members of the family, and it's so beautiful for you as members of the family to be able to hear us share our memories. Nancy was clearly a woman who understood the value of learning, and it's so nice to hear the story that you shared here of how she was convinced to return to Gallaudet after leaving. When I heard the story about Peter and Nancy, I was struck by a couple of things. For a deaf woman to be as successful as she was at her time, being married and then later going on to get a PhD while having children, required a great deal of commitment from a deaf husband, a man supporting her success as a woman. And seeing that, I see my mother in that same way. My father supported her as did many men to see the success of women. So I wanted to recognize Peter and thank you for your support of Nancy and her ambitions and her dreams. It's very important what you've done for her, and I wanted to note and recognize that. To see her determination, knowing exactly what she wanted, and then returning to Gallaudet, being willing to do so, complete her degree, and doing as well as she did academically is phenomenal. And then later deciding to go back to get a PhD. This was pre-Americans with Disabilities Act. I mean, young people in the room, and especially important here to recognize that she got her PhD at Catholic University back at a time when interpreters were not required for accessibility. There was no way for her to get access to her degree through sign language interpreters. So this was back in 1969, and for me to realize that, it just absolutely is amazing for me to consider all that it took for her to get her doctoral degree. And not even to mention the fact she had children, she had a husband, and doing all of these things in addition to studying. Doctorate degree. All of us in this room recognize that knowing her and seeing her go through that was a significant accomplishment. And I can see from the commitment of the individuals who share stories about Nancy since she's passed, just how much the community was there to support her along the way as well. You know, we heard about Albert was talking about his mother and the support the two of them had. You know, there's something about women in the deaf community, the way they rally around providing that support. It's so important to have a family and a spouse that's supportive. And just to mention how important spouses are, I like to use a sign that's gender neutral that really speaks to the sentiment of how two people come together united through their hearts. I think there are so many stories here we hear of what a wonderful woman she was and how she was surrounded by other women to achieve the dreams and ambitions that she had. You see that happening very often in the deaf community, taking turns to support one another. Many women in the room are witness to that, and speak to other women and help them achieve their success. And that's the value of the deaf community at Gallaudet, our ability to be there for one another, to help us achieve our dreams, all driven by the values that we as deaf people have. No matter who you are, every single person is important to our community. And Nancy is one of those people who was seen to be a person of significance. The history of her accomplishments and advocating and supporting others will live on in her legacy. To get her a doctorate degree as she did back in 1969, as the first deaf woman to get a PhD in English. Many, of course, were able to follow and get PhDs who were deaf after that. But that event, given the time, was a major accomplishment for a number of reasons. One being that she was building on the shoulders of those who came before her. There were women who were in the English department, who were deaf, who were teaching. And it was always pretty remarkable back then for a deaf person to teach English was seen to be a little certain that was something that the world would never imagine. How could a deaf person teach English? It didn't seem to be possible at all. But there were other deaf women in the English department teaching English, and then to have someone who went to get a PhD to move up through the ranks to become chair of the department was absolutely extraordinary during that time. Nancy also was one of the first wave of individuals to get a PhD as faculty members as deaf people, and then work here at Gallaudet. And now we have, of course, the majority of individuals here with PhDs who are working as faculty members who are deaf. She led the way, building upon the faculty and on our values that we as deaf people have, her deaf knowledge and hard-earned knowledge and expertise is what she was able to contribute to. And now the English department is diverse. She was responsible for hiring a number of deaf faculty members in the department, some of whom will be speaking today. So I'm happy to see members of the English department, in fact, here in the audience today. What I also understand about Nancy is just how she was able to assume leadership positions, and in doing so, guide Gallaudet through some very challenging times. Her ability to navigate all sides of the story, to know it was important to bring people along with her, despite the number of challenges she faced, she was able to lead us through those difficult times. And that's a remarkable skill for someone to have. I can see many who have benefited from being able to see the leaders such as Nancy. She left her mark here at Gallaudet. There's no doubt about that. And I also just have to share, because I see, you know, the leaders and the leadership displayed by Nancy. There are other faculty here at Gallaudet like Nancy, and their impact is just not the fact that they teach. There are some faculty who think that being a faculty member, they come here to Gallaudet, they teach, and after they teach, they go home and their day is over, and that's sufficient. But that's not typical. That's not the way our faculty engage here at Gallaudet. Our most beloved faculty members of this university are involved in deaf associations, GUAA, involved in things such as Nancy was, Deaf Citizens of America, Maryland Association of the Deaf. Her involvement in those organizations as a deaf citizen, displaying that deaf citizenship both in the classroom and outside of the classroom, is something to be recognized. The importance of her contributions and her ability to touch so many lives through these associations is remarkable. And that speaks to her deaf heart. I wanted to close with an image I have of her, something that just struck me because I was in law school when all this happened. I had just found out recently that my invitation to the Rose Garden in 1990 was assigned by the ADA. I couldn't afford to come to see the signing of the ADA, but I read that she was there to witness the signing. And I thought to myself, how fitting. That is an image I want all of us to hold and retain. Again, it displays her commitment to advocacy, to teaching, to learning, and to providing access. We remember her in the Rose Garden at the White House during the signing of the ADA. One of the most historically significant moments in our country and in our community's history. We send Nancy our gratitude and our grace. Well, that was just beautiful. So I would like to invite Jane Nickerson. Oh, I'm sorry.
the past 2 or 3 years, we would video phone each other, especially during COVID times, to make sure that we can support one another. So it was nice to be able to chat with her. I know a lot of the family members, Wayne, Dee, Linda, and now many more of you here today, which I very much appreciate. Nancy had quite a personality, am I right? She was beautiful, intelligent, had work ethic. She sang beautifully, and she was tall. She was quite tall. How tall was she? 5'8", 5'9"? 5'8", all right, so it's definitely taller than me. About 5'4", 5'5". Definitely look up. Boy, every time she asked me to do something, I could never say no. And with that in mind, I'm going to tell you a little bit of a story. Nancy retired back in 2008, I believe. I retired. Officially in August of 2018. I remember that clearly. Around April of 2018, Nancy was involved with the Maryland Senior Citizen Association. She was heavily involved with that group. They were going to have elections for their next officer cycle, and she was actively looking for people to volunteer to run for some of these positions. She actually came to my home. This was April of 2018. We chatted for quite a while. She asked me for a favor. She asked me to run for the one over here as the secretary. Any other guesses what she asked me to? English professor, and I am a writer, so maybe you can guess. In fact, she did ask me to be the secretary, or run for the position of secretary. And like I said, I could not say no to Nancy. But at that time, I could feel like a senior citizen. I have not retired yet. Remember, I am retiring in August, so this was 4 months prior. Regardless, I could not say no to Nancy. The elections were held in June, but maybe you may wonder what position I actually ran for. Vice President, Secretary, I see some guesses here. I actually ended up running as Treasurer, not Secretary. Nancy was pushing for that a little bit more, but you may wonder why she asked me to be Secretary. A month later after she had come to my house, she sent me an email. Quite a long email. She said, Cynthiia. She called me Cindy. She's like, there is another person who's very eager to run for secretary. I'm like, wait a minute. But you asked me. And by the way, Nancy said, the treasurer position is also open. Hint, hint, she wrote. And like I said, I cannot say no to Nancy. So I became the treasurer, a good treasurer, mind you. And the other person who was interested in being secretary became the secretary, and they were phenomenal. Thank you, everyone. I don't see any. I see here Joseph Rose. If not, let's move on to, I think I'm a little bit lost in the program. Oh, I think I missed one of Nancy's friends. Let me call her up to the stage, Jane Nickerson.
Hello, everyone. My name is Jane Nickerson, and I have the fortune to be a former colleague and friend of Nancy's within the English department. After she retired in 2004, we continued to stay in touch, mostly during the holidays. She had a newsletter every holiday around December. We always looked forward to, my husband and I always looked forward to reading the Kensicki family holiday letter each December so we could keep up with their lives and travel. In thinking back on Nancy's life, I just wanted to share a few reflections about what she meant to our department. Nancy was an excellent leader. She was a colleague who always wanted others to succeed. She was our department chair for several years, and she took that role quite seriously. I can remember her leading our department meetings with complete ease, even though we had a staff of 40 members within the department at that time. She also advised our junior faculty members so that they could become outstanding teachers. She continued to support them so that they could be promoted. She also supported other department chairs by providing them with wise advice. When discussing Nancy's life with other colleagues and other members of the department, the common thread was they would say she was a trailblazer. Because as we know, she was the first deaf woman to earn a PhD in English, and she was the first deaf person to become the English department chair. She recruited many people to our department and to teach, as she wanted excellent professors who would share their knowledge of English with our students. Many deaf women now teaching in the department here at Gallaudet all know how much Nancy supported them. Nancy was an excellent teacher. She loved to teach English. She loved to teach English literature, and her students truly appreciated this. They would say how much they loved her class. They would rave about classes. She really helped them love learning and reading. Nancy was committed to people and the work here that she did at Gallaudet University. She loved her students, supporting colleagues, worked on numerous committees, and supported the university. Every time I went to a committee meeting with her, I knew she was going to raise her hand to become the secretary of whatever that committee was. I will always remember Nancy as the person who took the best meeting minute notes for any meeting that I went to. Nancy was an extraordinary person, had an amazing life. We will all miss her. Thank you.
Thank you for those words. I'm not sure if I'm in the right order. Regardless, I would like to invite Roberta Rydstrom to the stage now. Most of the way around, I had them set. set in my mind where they were sitting.
Hello, good afternoon. I'm Rebecca Rydstrom. I'm the Executive Director of Gallaudet University Alumni Association, GUAA. And I'm here representing GUAA this afternoon. First, I really appreciate all of the stories you told about Nancy. I am just amazed about the dedication and every aspect she had to her life, her faculty membership, her family, and she also found time to volunteer for GUAA. And I'm going to talk a little bit about her contributions to this organization. She served as secretary. We're not surprised that she did that in two different time frames, in 1969 and also in 1992 to 2004. From my understanding from people that worked with her on GUAA, they all said that she was an excellent secretary. She did her job at ease, and everyone that worked with her had just peace of mind because she just did the job very eloquently. I'd like to talk a little bit more about the Graduate Fellowship Fund, that I'm going to call GFF. That's a huge scholarship program that GUAA has founded, and it's been in existence since 1968. And that's to fund deaf and hard of hearing individuals in their terminal degree studies, whether that be a PhD or JD or a master's MFA. She was involved in that committee and had been since 1980. She received her PhD in 1969, and she immediately joined that committee in 1970. During her tenure on the GFF committee from 1980 to 2021, she actually served for 41 years. That's the second longest person to volunteer that long. And during her tenure, she made it possible for 214 individuals to receive scholarships in total of $1.4 million. And those students, including the current president, President Cordano, was one of the scholarship recipients to go to law school. So that's just one example of the amazing things that she did. And that was a game changer for many deaf students. It was pre-ADA, American Disabilities Act. There was not a lot of resources and funds for students to pursue the degree. So this GFF fund made it possible for these students to get their terminal degree. They were very passionate, and she was very passionate. She showed it through her work that she did as a volunteer on these committees. I also want to recognize that Nancy was not only volunteering her time with the GFF, she also contributed funds and money to that scholarship fund. She also founded two additional scholarship funds here at Gallaudet. One is Kensicki Scholarship in English, and that was to support students that were majoring in English with financial support. She established that. She also established the Harry and Margaret Evans Journalism Award, and that was to support individuals who were wonderful in the field of journalism and provided funds to those students. So again, she taught here at Gallaudet, she was involved in GUAA, GFF. She was loved, and she loved this place, and she was very, very proud of her. She taught, she gave back to the community, she fundraised. Her time and dedication was astonishing. So thank you, Nancy, for making a difference. Thank you, Nancy, for showing your love to this university and being an example for all of us. Thank you.
So we will be concluding the program in just a few moments here. Oh, my apologies. I forgot something.
Notes.
I've got some notes in my heart, and I've got some notes in my mind. And I think with that, I'll say what I need to say and speak from the heart. I hope you don't mind. I knew Nancy for a very long time. She was a very good friend of mine. And what I'll say about her is it was not about her work at Gallaudet University, not to me anyway. It was the work that she did outside of Gallaudet University, DSA, Maryland Association for the Deaf, and the Senior Citizen Association that she was a part of. Everyone in the deaf community loved Nancy, both at DSA, Deaf Seniors of America, and the Maryland Senior Citizen Association. Maryland Deaf Senior Citizen Association. She was a member of both organizations, and everyone who was also a member loved Nancy. She did some outstanding work with those organizations. She had immaculate work. Every time she met with the board, you could just see lots and lots of happy faces. She was very well loved, and everyone had a smile on their face when they saw her, really. She always came in with a big smile as well. She saved the Maryland Senior Citizen Association. They were in trouble, and they were struggling to handle the center. Where would they meet? In the Schweihart Center is where they met. And then they had to move out of that building. They could no longer use it as a meeting room any longer. This was in 2010 or thereabouts. And we, as members of the Maryland Deaf Senior Organization, were upset. The president at that time, I was president at that time, and I was very upset because we loved that meeting space. It was a wonderful building. And we were fighting with the management of the building, going back and forth. And there was nowhere for us to meet, so we had four people to deal with Montgomery County Commission. Of course, Nancy was one of those four. She was an excellent leader. And she was willing to work hard for the Maryland Deaf Senior Citizen Organization. She went to these meetings in Rockville, Maryland, and went into that commission. And we weren't getting anywhere. They demanded a face-to-face meeting with the commissioner. The commissioner was one person. And during that meeting, we argued for our rights as deaf people to continue to use that meeting space once a month. The commissioner was blown away to hear all of this and immediately told the management that we could keep that building space and have kept it ever since. Very grateful to Nancy and the other three individuals who took on that fight. Nancy was a wonderful DSA secretary for more than 8 years, from 2010 approximately. I was the treasurer at that time, and I very much enjoyed working with her. Always so pleasant, always wrote so well, always very helpful to everyone who was in the room, just a wonderful human being. I'm going to miss her. Okay, Nancy, I hope you're watching us today. I hope you are with us, and I want you to know that we are thankful to you for all of your contributions in so many ways. So thank you, Nancy. We miss you.
friends and family, I have seen a thread in all various speakers' comments today, and it's clear to me that Nancy is loved dearly. Conversations with one another during the reception this afternoon in the back of the room. And that concludes our formal program. And I would like to please do forgive me, I apologize. We have one more presenter this afternoon. Nancy Chough. lost contact.
Lost contact with a lot of individuals in 2022, actually. Now looking back and I'm talking about Nancy, and I thought it was kind of weird. I was Nancy, and she was Nancy. And my sign name is the same as hers. So we both had the same sign name. And when we had this plan, an email that I got for the memorial service, I thought my twin sister, Nancy, and we said D because it was easy for me to say Nancy D. So I thought that was really odd that we had so many similarities growing up and we were friends and we were in the same class. There's the act of Nancy that we are in this room instead of the old gym.
I didn't know anybody that had her skill and expertise, and I thought, oh my gosh, what are we going to do? 2016. Myself and another individual worked together, and when Dee announced that Nancy had actually passed away, we were all heartbroken. So I typed up an email and sent it to Astrid with, forwarded Dee's announcement, of course. I said, please send this out to all of our classmates and ask for some donations in her honor. And those donations should go to the 1965 class fund. A couple days after, Dee said, I'd like to contribute this fund to the Evans Family Fund. And it could be either or fund. And I thought, oops, I should have checked with Dee first before I made this assumption. I couldn't ask people's donations to be moved to that other fund, to the Evans fund, her family fund. So, our goal, of course, was to raise $25,000 to contribute to this fund and this money to what we wanted to as a class. So thank you very much.
Thank you.